Good evening, and welcome everyone to Corpus Christi Parish. Your merciful love, O God, we have received in the midst of your temple. Your praise, O God, like your name, reaches the ends of the earth. Your right hand is filled with saving justice. We have a few announcements before we begin. A farewell party for Father Jacob will be in the parish office after Mass today. Do we have anyone here with birthdays this month? One? Dare I ask how old? 74, yay. And how about anniversaries? How many years? About 40. 40, all right. Congratulations. Anyone else? Happy anniversary. Our main celebrant at this Mass is Father Jacob. Assisting him is Deacon Bob. The special intention of this Mass is for Travis Lear. We begin by singing together hymn number 203. Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, how good to be here in the presence of the Lord and to gather as his people. In order that we might be worthy to stand before him, we first call to mind our sins and ask his pardon and peace.
Lord Jesus, you call the obstinate of heart to heed you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your grace is sufficient to aid our weakness and make us strong. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your wisdom and mighty deeds are astonishing. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you.
Let us pray. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy, for on those you have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. As the Lord spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard the one who was speaking say to me, Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have revolted against me to this very day. Hard of face and obstinate of heart are they to whom I am sending you. But you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God, and whether they heed or resist, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that a prophet has been among them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. To you I lift up my eyes, who are enthroned in heaven. As the eyes of servants are on the hands of their masters, our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. As the eyes of a maid are on the hands of her mistress, so are our eyes on the Lord our God, till he has pity on us. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. Have pity on us, O Lord, have pity on us. For we are more than sated with contempt. Our souls are more than sated with the mockery of the ignorant, with the contempt of the proud. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, that I, Paul, might not become too elated because of the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, an angel of Satan to beat me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I begged the Lord about this, that it might leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. I will rather boast most gladly of my weaknesses, in order that the power of Christ may dwell with me. Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and constraints for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong." The word of the Lord.
Be to God. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus departed from there and came to his native place, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many heard him and were astonished. They said, "Where did this man get all of this? What kind of wisdom has been given him? What mighty deeds are wrought at his hands? Is he not the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph, Judas and Simon? And are not all his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his native place and among his own kin and in his own house." So he was not able to perform any mighty deeds there apart from curing a few sick people by laying his hands on them. He was amazed at their lack of faith. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Folks, our Lord is mighty and powerful indeed. And I can give you some examples. When the Levite Korah and his sons had contempt for Moses and for the prophecy of the Lord through Moses, and they wanted to take the place in front of the tabernacle, the earth swallowed them, opened its mouth, and consumed them. When Uzzah the Levite dared to stretch out his hand to even touch the Ark of the Covenant, which he was not permitted to do, he dropped dead on the spot. And when a bunch of children made fun of Elisha the prophet and told him to go home, Baldy, which is recorded in God's holy scriptures, Elisha turned to the Lord, he prayed for deliverance, and 2 bears came out of the woods and mauled them to death. The Lord is mighty and full of power, and he is well able to defend himself from dishonor, from disobedience, from contempt and scorn. I would have you remember the thing about Elisha as I'm leaving today and as I'm going forth from the parish, about making fun of the bald. I bring all this up because today we hear about weakness. And especially in the second reading, we hear about weakness and St. Paul talking about his weakness. But St. Paul is not talking about his weakness as though it is in contrast to the Lord. When the Lord God, who is the maker of heaven and earth, who is mighty and powerful in all his works, wanted to come and reveal himself most fully to us. Now, when the earth swallowed Korah, when Uzzah the Levite dropped dead, and when those children were mauled by bears, was God revealing something about himself? Yes, he was. He was. That's why it's in the scriptures. But when God wanted to most fully reveal himself and show himself to us, he did not come in the whirlwind like he came to Job. He did not come in the flood like he cleansed the earth in the time of Noah. He came in a man, weak and contemptible. And when his own people in his own hometown scorned him and dismissed him, there was no fire coming down to consume the town. There was no earth to swallow them up. He performed no mighty deeds there, only curing a few sick people, and was amazed at their lack of faith. And then he left them alone. So the weakness that we hear St. Paul talk about, a weakness which applies to us, certainly, is not some kind of weakness like that separates us from the Lord. And that's very important. And in fact, when the Lord Jesus Christ wanted to reveal himself, he became weak and poor and took the form of a slave, a weak human. Then when he wanted to do the greatest possible saving work, not only that God has ever done, but that it is possible to imagine him doing, the greatest work he possibly could do, giving over his own life to give his life into you and you and you and all who have been baptized in water and received the Eucharist, his blood that came from his side on the cross. The greatest work of power and salvation that God ever could have done. How did he do it? By becoming as weak as it is possible to imagine someone becoming. By becoming as weak as it's possible to be. This is how God's might is at work in the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the same might that is in work in you and in me for our salvation today. The weakness that St. Paul talks about does not put us in contrast with our Lord. It puts us with him. With him. And this is very important. You know, when, like, the Greeks wanted to talk about strength, they talked about, like, Hercules and Theseus and Achilles and all of these. When we want to talk about what it is to be a Christian, we talk about the saints. And sometimes people rather dismissively place these things as though they're similar, but when you actually read the stories, they are not similar at all. Now, on the one hand, one is mythological and one is mostly historical. But that aside, the stories of the saints are nothing like the stories of Hercules, of Theseus, of Achilles. Because what made Hercules great, I mean, he's not real, but what made him great is that he always had the strength to overcome whatever. Except like his own passions, which is a telling thing. But he always had the strength to clean the stables, to wrestle the demigod thing, to whatever. Hercules always had the strength to do it. Theseus always had the strength and the wits to do it. What makes St. Patrick great? It is not that St. Patrick always had the strength for much of anything or always had the wits. It's that St. Patrick, an escaped slave, had the courage and the love to go back to his place of slavery as a witness to the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what makes St. Patrick great. What makes St. Paul great? In the rest of this passage, which we've kind of cut out our second reading, we hear about what made St. Paul great. Beatings and shipwreck and danger of death at sea and on the road and being stoned a couple times. And then eventually becoming so weak as to be led to Rome by soldiers and beheaded. And this is Paul's strength. This is Paul's strength. What makes him so great, because he did it as a witness to the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. The heroes of our faith and the ones we are invited to emulate, and not just emulate like from outside, like they did it, so I gotta try real hard to do it, but to emulate from inside, right? I am united with Paul, actually, in my prayers, in my baptism, and when I receive communion. You are united with St. Patrick, who had that courage and that witness to love, actually, not just that you've got to work real hard to do what he did. You are actually joined to him because you share a baptism with him, which means you share a life with him, the life of the Lord. You share his nourishment that made him that strong. Every time you receive from this table, you share the same spirit that inspired him to do it when you've been confirmed. We are not separate from St. Patrick or different from him. We are the same as him, at least potentially, if we will be. And if we won't be, it's not because we didn't have the resources. It's because we chose not to be. The saints are so great because they are witnesses to the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they get their greatness and their strength how? What we said a few times in our psalm today, our eyes are fixed on the Lord. Where did St. Paul get the love and the courage and the perseverance to continue and continue and continue? Because his eyes were fixed on the Lord. And because his eyes were fixed on the Lord, he experienced in stonings, beatings, danger, shipwrecks, danger at sea, danger on land. He has this whole list that he goes through. Not just some hard thing he had to be strong enough to get through, but he saw in these things, and truthfully, the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ in him. Where did St. Patrick get the courage and the love to go back to the people who had kidnapped and enslaved him as a witness to the Lord Jesus Christ? Because his eyes were fixed on the Lord. And the love to forgive those people and be an apostle to those people did not come from St. Patrick's heart or his human love for them. It came from the love of Christ in him, placed in him. And it is the same with us, brothers and sisters. We don't have to be great enough to overcome whatever the current struggle is. You don't have to be wise enough to figure out, like Theseus, whatever puzzle is put in front of you, and you don't have to be patient enough with your own patience to put up with even your own family or whoever else is bothering you. We keep our eyes fixed on the Lord. And when our eyes are fixed on the Lord, then when we are weak, we find the strength. Then we are not separate from the Lord Jesus Christ, or just trying to work real hard to overcome him, or be strong enough or wise enough or whatever enough like some Greek hero. Then we find the resources, because we find them in the Lord. And we find them not in these great shows of strength, at least not most of the time. We find them in the cross. And that is a weakness that doesn't separate us from the Lord or make us further from him, but rather that unites us with him. May our eyes always be fixed on the Lord, day in and day out. And then we will find, even in our weakness, the strength of the Lord and the love of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters, together we profess the faith. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for our sake and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnated of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, and according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds with the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and a life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord Jesus was rejected by his own people. In faith, we accept him as our Lord and Savior, and we pray in his name.
For Bishop Johnson, in his prophetic ministry of teaching the Catholic faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who serve society in police and fire forces, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elderly and those with disabilities who find Christ's power in their weakness, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a deeper devotion to Mary in our community, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for our sick and those who grieve, and for those who have died in Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
So for the National Eucharistic Revival, especially for the Congress coming up in Indiana in a week and a half, and for the pilgrimages that pass through our own community a little while ago and that continue on their way, that many will come to a deeper love of the Lord in the Eucharist, and united to him there may keep their eyes always fixed on the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let's pray also for Father Luisito Cabrera, who was ordained just a couple weeks ago now, and who will be joining us here as our new associate pastor, that God will continue to bless him and help him, and that he will be a blessing to very many people here. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In your goodness, Heavenly Father, hear the petitions of your people who ask all these things through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our preparation song is number 405, Open My Eyes.
Open my ears.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and the glory of his name,
for our sake and all his holy church.
May this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, O Lord, and day by day bring our conduct closer to the life of heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Christ our Lord. Through him the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord.
For, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Patrick and Saint Paul, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy. Grant us
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Come to me, all you who labor and are heavily burdened, and I will give you rest, says the Lord.
Our communion song is number 348, Taste and See, 348.
Goodness of the Lord.
me overhead.
Soul of my Savior, sanctify my life. Body of Jesus, save me from all strife.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Well, what a joy to be with you all today. There are just a couple announcements. One is that I need to very, very briefly meet with our sacristans in the sacristy after Mass. Very briefly. So we'll meet there. And another, this is my last weekend here as the associate at Corpus Christi Parish, which has been one of the greatest blessings of my life, truly. So thank you to all of you. It's been a wonderful place. And thank you to all of you who have taught me many things and have been very patient with me also over the last 3 years. This is truly a wonderful place, and I hope you know that. Sometimes I think maybe people sometimes don't, but it's a wonderful place. I've experienced that for 3 years now. Thanks be to God. There is a party for me. It's not in the social hall because we are waxing the floors this weekend, so it is over in the offices across the parking lot. And that's all I had to announce. Remember, we come to the Lord. Our weakness does not separate us from the Lord. Our weakness unites us with him who became weak to save us. We are not heroes like Greek myth or whatever that get out of things by their strength or by their wits. Even if we do get out of something by our strength or by our wits, right? The greatest problems in life, you can't outsmart death, you can't outwit loneliness. You can't, the things Jesus really came to save us from are not things that you can be a hero about. It is in our weakness that we are strong, and it's in the weakness of Christ and of the cross that we find salvation. This is the promise of the Lord. So we ask him to be with us always and to give us the grace to remain with him. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Our sending forth song is number 615. 6:15, Your Grace Is Enough.